Vultures. Vultures circle over a desolate, nameless desert. They follow a shadow that they think for good reason will feed them well. All signs are there. Everything is set for a real master chef dinner, a buffet. Since the shadow silhouette gets its nourishment from human weakness, arrogance, envy, and stupidity. So, the vultures await in this moment at an out-of-reach distance. They think they know. Reality, however, finds its way along a different road. They have made this mistake several times before. Because they lack a very essential component of the truly difficult equation hidden in the social game that we in this story are going to witness. A timeless multidimensional narrative that moves in the shadow of the riches of life, and in its vanity. Sir Francis Bacon, the founder of the modern science ideals, described its essence in his theory of false theories. Although this is only the symptoms of a disease that all people suffer from time to time. But for others, about whom this story is going to focus on, it is the leading star through all their adult lives. Neat paths of stone that in almost straight angles forces its way to the entrance of the grey, slightly hidden house. The footsteps are almost soundless as she slowly approaching the iron gate. Every sensory experience, every little change that was not there yesterday, is preserved tenderly. The morning's dewy time is the time of day when she can be herself. She quickly glances up to the sky and finds that according to the clouds it appears that it will rain later. The darkening clouds form a progressively thicker mat. Well, why would this day be different than other days? She thinks calmly. Anyhow, usually it does not rain. Soon she has left her tidy garden behind and speeding up her steps. 8 hours behind, a cashier awaits. She hesitates as usual. Annoyed of the thought, can I really have chosen this? The giant department store is already in sight when she undergoes her usual metamorphosis. Now the grey old woman appears that she does not want to be, but that everyone knows so well. Lisbeth greets the security guard with slight distasteful look on her way in. As usual, she has arrived half an hour too early. The theories about why she does this are many. She, herself, sees it as something not out of the ordinary, without being able to communicate any detailed reasons for the act. Nevertheless, it has not always been like this. For many years, she used to rush through the staffing entrance at the last minute just like everyone else. However, with the sadness followed new habits. It was a foggy time. You can take everything as long as you get out of my sight, was what he said. Then he who had promised so much was out of her life for good, while she became the talk of the town. And of course, her town was that kind of small town where gossip was the only vital injection in life. So, everything about her was turned inside and out. It had felt like that there were whispers in every street corner that she passed by, that she became a sacrificial lamb that was ripped apart a second time in the darkest alley of human shallowness. First deceived, and then the streets mob who found her guilty, that she was the one to blame. These people, the whisperers, were her only friends now. In the ruins of her crashed marriage, only those people were to be found in the waste of her life. Shallow sympathy is nevertheless sympathy. During these brutally mad weeks, she became part of this subculture. As it is open to anyone who lacks the ability to live their own life. She had found her alibi, her guardian wall. Her red lipstick surpasses the color of the button of the fire alarm in strength. The color should be taken for what it really is. A warning signal, a traffic light that says stop, stay where you are, turn away, while there still is time, because here I come. For some, the warning sign appears too late. Like for example, Jeanette, that she just passing by where she sits by her delicatessen counter, and looks sad. An innocent kiss after a glass too much on a staff party had been enlarged to a cover story for everyone to know about. She has been fighting for months with her relationship. It hurts inwardly to repeatedly denying the rumor that emphasizes her infidelity. The man who was soon to be her husband struggles to believe her, but the love that has always been so strong is now staggering from time to time. An evil smile, an underlying hint, and the light that has existed in his eyes suddenly changes to darkness, like if the eyes were closed. The shame of being outcast for something that he knows somewhere far deep inside is not true. It creates chaos. Jeanette stubbornly meets Lisbeth's eyes and holds on tight. Both refuses to give in. Then Lisbeth's face is breaking up in a smile and greet cheerfully. Jeanette mumbles a hello and turn away. The distaste must be hidden in favor of the quiet facade of the workplace. Lisbeth's footsteps echo on the stone floor. They signal an emptiness that hits Jeanette in the stomach and digging further in the cavity, that wound, that itch and aches day and night. She decides to start the day with a smoke break. A bad habit she has embraced recently. She meets Kirsten on the way to the smoking spot. The purchasing manager greets with a smile and Jeanette greets back a little low. Just imagine that she could get a manager position, Jeanette thinks. That Kirsten, who had been bullied so much in school with her German accent and strange clothing, and a general nerdiness. Jeanette is glad she did not belong to the inner circle of the bully gang. That she followed the advice that her father gave her, to be kind to the nerds because you will work for them one day. This wisdom he repeated constantly. He never knew that his words would turn to reality, that he probably saved her from a lot of pain. In other darker moments, she only harshly wondered who Kirsten slept with to get where she is now. However, mostly, she was still impressed by Kirsten, who had obtained a university degree and was forced into constant struggle in the grade male world of management. But because of the risk of reprisals, this admiration could only exist in secrecy. She prays softly that the smoking spot is empty, must regain the calm, must survive yet another day. Just pull down the smoke in the lungs without any need for explanations. By the front door, another thought strikes and grows into a shivering, then this day would go from bad to become the worst possible. Jeanette stops in the middle of a step as she is about to step out. It is not her day today. Everything seems to have turned against her. It is time to quit smoking is her first clear thought as she makes a total turnaround. Nevertheless, the escape cannot happen in secret because he has already seen her. When he a few minutes later passes her busy delicatessen counter, she pretends to be unaware of their previous almost meeting. The fat grey-haired man goes with heavy steps to the elevator. On his door at the office floor the sign says, Staff Manager, and the name infringed. The smoke cough hangs in the air like a nausea for several minutes after he has returned to his office. Jeanette again tries to convince herself that it is an omen. A sign from heaven that this is the day she will let go of her bad habit. No more visits to the smoking spot, her breath will taste mint again, after the pastilla that she likes. In the meantime, Lisbeth has changed her clothes and is at her checkout desk. In 20 minutes, she will open the supermarket gates as she has done in the past 20 years. It has been 2 decades of waiting. A wait for the retirement day, when she finally will cut the finish line and finally start living. Unfortunately, she lacks visions of what that means. Lisbeth shivering at the thought that everything will remain as usual. Just more time to kill. She takes out the hidden bottle of window cleaner and injects carefully the checkout band and all the other free surfaces. Soon all visible surfaces are polished, and the by now black cloth manifests that the cleaning woman, as usual, has not done her job properly. But Lisbeth does not know that the cleaning woman went to her boss after their last dispute. And this young man asked the cleaning lady to not clean Lisbeth's workplace. Because there was obviously already a cleaner available for this spot, according to him. For a long time, she has felt ignored. Despite her continual remarks, despite repeated attempts to conversation, she has only received silence in reply in the recent years. Like if not only herself, but also everyone else awaits her retirement. So much deeper than that, her thoughts about herself do not usually go. It is after all her main mission to keep track of everyone else's life and living. Even if it is a self-assigned role to keep an eye on all the imbalances and let everybody know about it. She thinks she provides an important contribution and that she is doing it very well. This she believes everybody must agree upon. And as long as she hears her own voice, the wheezing silence from her environment is not so unpleasant to handle. The first customer appears at the same moment she has formed her strategy for the day. The cashier band is rolling with a well-known crunching. A bag of buns and the customer pays with cash. The coin machine is raging, and everything is done. But Lisbeth is not aware of one important detail, not yet, as this will turn out to be an extraordinary day. Since usually she only walks around during her breaks and reproduce the old stuff, today something new, something marvelous, is coming her way. In the head, a Ferris wheel spins faster. Thousand thoughts are soaring. Kirsten cannot possibly concentrate on the malicious sound of the staff manager, Inchfred's voice. Especially as it appears in the shake of his fat body contours of grey and beige. However, it is what he is communicating that is the most painful. Many words fall out that completely lack content. The Ferris wheel is speeding up after a slow start, and Kirsten is preparing herself for confrontation. Especially since Viking, who ought to be the CEO, is as usual pale in his opposition to defending the reorganization proposal. Certainly, he had begun with a trusting quote, "We should not do what we are used to, but do what is right." But after that, his arguments quickly began to fall flat. Kirsten had been given the task of drawing up a PM, since the staff manager did not think he had time to do it. The staff manager concludes his sleepy monologue that the new purchasing manager should probably get a little warmer in the clothes first. He makes an artful pause, and his telling look stays in Kirsten's modest cleavage across the table. It is patronizing, destructive eyes as if she were his secretary, and has interfered in a question that is way out of her league. Kirsten meets his eyes and imprisoning them until he let go. While he says that nobody wins anything by yet another reorganization, it only creates anxiety. She lets her eyes make a tour to monitor the reaction of the grey men around the table. Still neutral, Kirsten determines the status and starts talking. Yet another reorganization, she asks, but the last one was done 15 years ago. You're probably the only one that was involved that still are working here. A slight laugh and general smile break out, but decreases rapidly. Many things has happened on the market and around the world since then. She has got their sincere attention, and she presents the hard facts about that the supermarket loses market share, that the administration is too heavy, and then follows a business intelligence analysis, and how well her proposal is designed to solve this. Then suddenly the meeting breaks for lunch to everyone's joy. When she returns to the conference room an hour later, she finds a note on the door. The meeting continues in the sauna by the training room. She has been excluded. Kirsten swears silently and thinks of her different options. Then she closes her hand angrily into a fist. If they want to fight, they will get a fight. With fast steps she enters the basement where the gym is located. Suddenly she realizes that the sauna must mean the sauna inside the men's changing room. Her movement stops and for a few seconds she hesitates. What the fuck, she then mumbles, and deeply hope that the sauna is located like in the ladies' dressing room, that means before entering the room for clothes change. Without more than a fraction of a second of reflection time, the anger returns, and she virtually throws herself into the ladies' room. The undressing is made in a hurry. with a bathing cloth around her. Without more reflection, she is soon with small tripping steps by the door. The men's changing room design is thankfully a copy of the room she just left. Through the immense glass window, she sees the fat to half-fat old men's bodies. The sound testifies that the meeting may already have begun. She nervously pushes her fingers to correct the towel and hesitates by the door, time for round two. The steams hit her, and she swallows a vomit of distaste and agony. "Have you started without me?" she says with a light tone, when she becomes visible at the door. The expression is neutral despite the sting of the distaste that she not completely has been able to wipe away, and it keeps on attacking in wave after wave. Breathlessness. Some is turning little unpleasantly. Besides this, no movement can be monitored since everyone seems to have lost their breath. After a few seconds, the oxygen returns to the sauna again. The market manager Claes Vikander finds words the fastest. He is a man around 50 who spreads a comfortable calm around him. "No, but now we can start," he says slowly. "But where is Viking?" replies Kirsten. "At the hospital with his youngest son," answers Vikander. She sits down on the time-worn wooden bench. The heat is suffocating, and she feels the looks wandering over her body. A new blast of disgust strikes her, but again she succeeds to choke it. "What am I doing here? Is it really worth it?" she thinks as the silence continues. Then she gently tries to start the discussion. Not much is being said. Inge's hope that in peace and without interference, convince the others, she has spoiled. When they end the meeting, she knows that she has won the battle. The purchasing department is taking the lead as a pilot case, and it is important to show results. In order to win round 3 and 4 on knockout. The tension decreases as she gets back to her dressing room. "Damn, damn, damn," is the only thing that runs through her foggy head. With trembling fingers, she locks the door, letting the sweaty towel fall to the floor and entering the shower. Under the hot streams of water, her body functions slowly return to normal. She gives herself time. Therefore, she does not hear how the door handle is gently pressed down, and then a small pull, but the door remains locked. Afterwards, after a long time standing and cleaning off all the dirt, and then, let the toweling do its job, she is finally ready to meet world again. With a neutral face expression, she swings the door open. The corridor is empty. She walks a few staggering steps to make sure. Soon, the heels cling toward the stone floor at a normal pace. On the shop floor, she waves towards Jeanette, but gets only a questioning expression in return. She probably just has a bad day, Kirsten thinks distracted. But the strange responses continue when she passes others in the staff. The evil smile that Lisbeth does not manage to hide proves that everyone else knows something that Kirsten does not know. The compact silence that accompanies the hilarious rumor makes the situation unbearable. Kirsten trotting the last meters towards the stairs. She neither can nor want to take the elevator, with fear of meeting someone. The lump in her throat risks bursting into crying tears. She still not understands what she has said or done. Once inside her office, she carefully closes the door. The discomfort is still there. But here is no one who feeds it. No vultures that circles. Nor any mischievous actions that is soaring. It is a free zone, so she decides to lock her door and stay there. After the lock has clicked, she is taking a book from her handbag. Sir Francis Bacon is on the cover, and the title, A Novum Organum. She always carries it with her as a reminder. As she never has been able to free herself from the intellectual atmosphere of her university time. In the little industrial community where she grew up, and now lives in again, nothing of this existed. The few who still have a clue and are familiar with this environment, they hide it well. Here, theatre performances were never reviewed on stage, only the theatre of life was reviewed with cuts and punches as an outcome. Here the free fields of creativity are abolished for the sake of narrow-mindedness. The worst sin you ever can reveal yourselves with is to show who you really are. Kirsten quickly browses to the theory of false theories, and then she begins to read, slowly. Four categories, which has she been a victim of? Idola tribus, the first directive deals with the prejudices that fall into the imperfection of human nature in the form of delusions. It is based on a general human laziness that emerges in collective contexts when too many brains join together and create monsters of exceptional nature. Such social games that usually idle people can create is like an acidified stagnant water that without new influences, without new driving forces, will slag until the community completely drown in the mud. In sharp contrast to the human curiosity that should lead the way. Kirsten remains sitting for several minutes to taste each word, each subordinate phrase, every breath of understanding. Surely, she feels familiar with this spirit. It seems to be this idola that has hit her. Perhaps she does not even have to read on. To not learn more of Bacon's directives, but curiosity and knowledge thirst is driving her forward. She reads Idola Speakus, that is the second directive that takes on an individual's personal shortcomings. Where your own mistakes and losses is awakening the envy of others' true or imagined successes. Here, the envy is the source of human prejudice and exhaustion of the mind under the motto, that we will never be able to accomplish that, let's hit back, to take the object of the envy down to the bottom. Kirsten rapidly continues to read. She knows the essence of envy so well. The third directive's starting point is linguistic mistakes. Idola Fori is based on diffuse sentences, meaning communication is characterized by ambiguity. Where the words chosen are chosen only because they can be perceived in different ways. A split tongue can often spread the worm's poison much more efficiently than the one that is specific. Some people use their entire creativity to conceal ambiguities about others, without having to take responsibility for what they have said. Because if they are still dragged to court, they can only say that it was by no means my opinion, that it should not be interpreted in such devious way. Kirsten feels a cold sting of discomfort search its way along the spine. The snakes may be the hardest to resist. As no quick solution shows itself, she quickly progresses to the fourth directive of Idola Theatri. Bacon defined this directive as false sketches of knowledge systems, where the distortion mechanisms are so strong that it distorts the senses of the masses into a wasteland that not really exists. A place where you do not use the sense of reason, nor the experience you have gained along your way. Kirsten once again let her thoughts play freely and she smiles. These idols Bacon meant that everybody has to free oneself from, and that it is a work that takes a lot of time. In particular, in such an environment that Kirsten is living within and was growing up in. Here it is necessary to take personal responsibility to find new perspectives and new paths. At the same time as a significant part of the culture counteracts with such initiatives. Outside Kirsten's door, the story is being sketched with the idolatry's tools. Since the executives' meeting has developed into a sauna orgy in the mind of the crowd, where only the imagination sets the limit. Jeanette is sitting at Lisbeth's table in the coffee room for the first time in a very long time, appreciating the idea that now the rumors of herself will quickly be forgotten. The little sting of compassion she nevertheless feels, she tries to reject. There is no room for taking the victim's side. Especially not for her, since her own reputation would once again end up in the line of fire and become doubled with Kirsten's misconduct. Above their heads, the vultures circle. They are closer now. At the coffee machine, the laugh gurgles, it rolls along the walls as targeting projectiles. Lisbeth is silent with a blasphemous smile over her red lips, while Intfreged, the staff manager, without limitations increasing the scope of the anecdote. All his big fat body shedding of the attention. "What a drama queen," he said, "she just came in without a thread on her body. Incredible. We just had to take a much-needed break, and there she came, and waved with her breasts." He makes a theatrical pause to give the audience's sense of evilness a chance to grow. "Honestly," he says, "there was not much to see." The staff manager makes another theatrical gesture that evolves into a roaring coughing attack. While the gathered crowd awaits the second part of the scandal that now occupies their senses. "At last, this damn Kirsten will get what she deserves," states the collective twisted consciousness. "That snobbish woman with an extraordinary degree and fat bank account. Not to mention the position as a manager, yes, now they had the proof of what had been so clear all the time. That she had obviously been very close to the owners of the store. Of course, she had. And from such mindset, the rumor is accelerating." As Claudio Magris writes, the fear knocks on the door, Faith goes to open it, outside stands nobody. In this case, the staff manager is spreading the unease. The wishes of the gathered crowd's mind open the senses to create their own fantasy stories. This is how the envy's fuel works. A life-consuming power that finally destroys everything that comes in its way. Kirsten takes a deep breath, and then lets the open book soundly fall onto the desk. Outside the window, the darkness is lowering its shadows. A street lamp lights up. Besides this, everything is awkwardly quiet. As if the building gathering breath before a new clash of malicious rumors. She should be used to it. She tries to convince herself. She should be able to stand strong. After all, this is where she grew up. She knows the rules of the game. Any slight divergence from the ordinary will be magnified into twisted colors. If there is only the slightest hint that the mob can include sex or drunkenness in the gossip, then the happiness is complete. It is an impossible situation. A simple moment 22 where Kirsten must lose in one way or the other. The thoughts spin like a swirling wind. Solutions nevertheless does not come in her way. How can she regain her dignity in the eyes of the mob outside her door? Then doubt is storming in. It strikes its sharp claws around her thoughts and keeps them entangled. How could she be so stupid? How could she even think about going into that crowd of men in the sauna? Obviously, the rumors would spread. Clearly, she would be considered as promiscuous. She tries to fight the thoughts. Trying to turn it off. Trying to find the real reason between cause and effect. Trying to break the common paths that she grew up with. Then suddenly, after a few more treacherous seconds, she sees everything clearly. It was the rebel in her who had acted. The rebel who could not stand to be violated as a woman. Especially when she is struggling much harder than most others. The rebel that once and for all wanted to make up with the old that in practice means. Grayed old men in a gray beige suit. The rebel that had been created by her education that made it possible to identify and take arms against a method used in most cultures for thousands of years. Whose inner core consists of excluding half of the world's population from decision-making outside the doors of their home. Humanity should be better than that. But instead of a hero's gloria, the vultures are hovered just above her head. They get their nutrition of envy. In this obscure darkness, she must be the light that makes everybody see. The rebel that shows everything in black on white, that the black is in fact white in this case. The war inside of her ends abruptly with this conclusion. She takes a deep breath and raises Nova Morganum to her lips. And then kisses the book sincerely. It is her weapon in the coming battle. Twilight falls rapidly. The office is probably already deserted, she thinks, when she unlocks the door and steps out in the corridor, which is thankfully empty. Unintentionally, she breathes out and steers her steps in a relaxed speed. The inward smile is widening, while a twisted sting of desire to meet someone makes her stop. The body tightening as if someone really would come in her way. Suddenly, she takes her Nokia phone out of her handbag, as she sees how a string of light shows under the door to the right. The second later, without further reflection, she presses the door handle while she makes a light click with her other hand. His roaring smoke cough echoes when he frightened turns his eyes towards the door. Almost as if he has been caught in an indecent manner. In a few seconds, the air is standing still. Then he shuts the open box back into his desk before Kirsten gets to see what is in it. No, but look at you, he says breathlessly, to in the next second replace the mindset, as if he suddenly recalls something, but wasn't it a very successful meeting today? The irony and malice are ringing in every syllable. But Kirsten only gives him a cheeky smile, and meets his eyes. Well, I wouldn't want to call it that. Poorly planned, expected results, and a number of fat disgusting guys who should have kept their clothes on. Imagine all this effort to keep me out. She notices sudden shift as he dazed look for words. Then he says the magic words. Those who will echo through grey corridors, to the lit office rooms, straight up to the CEO, and the department store's board, and then down to ground level to the entire staff. Words of the old grey clan when they are sure that nobody, but their victim, hears. You must understand facts, he says in an unpleasant tone, women does not belong here, stay out of our way. Inchfredged smiles happily, smiles like if he filled his fat stomach with something very appetizing, a smile from old dreadful times, which becomes wider when he notices that she is turning away her eyes. Victory. She cannot even respond. Then the last wall breaks, and he says, do you really think you can stay here when the entire staff and management team regard you as the whore you are? Surely, I did it well, didn't I? I really noticed how you suffered. That was really wonderful. Kirsten gives him a vague smile, which he only perceives as a sign of weakness and defeat. So that's how you look at it. She said with a neutral voice. Of course, damn it, he answered harshly. That's all then, she recalls quietly, almost dreamingly. He never notices the shift in her tone. However, it is anyway too late, way too late. She turns slowly and puts her feet back in motion out through the door. The footsteps speed up as soon as she is out of sight. Then when she is inside the waiting elevator, and the doors has closed, and her fumbling fingers finally find the stop button and clicks. Not for the elevator, but on the small mobile phone she has in her hand. She then watches the show that is an almost 2 minute long movie clip that has just been recorded. When it ends, she is breaking out in a victory dance that lasts until the doors open again. Safely out in the cold night, she knows exactly what to do, must have more, gain more. She laughs out in the night. Everything will turn out to be magnificent this way. A new day is showing its neutral face. She walks with a sunken head, does not want to look anyone in their eyes, does everything to show that she is defeated. When she looks up at a glance, the indifference she has often felt from many people now has been replaced with malice. The losers have received justice according to the general opinion. Losers because they are considering themselves in that way. And then it turned out that in fact it was her, that Kirsten, who was also a loser just like them. So good that everyone loses, so nice. Since they think that it is still too many nuances in their black and white world. Better to paint everything in black. The staff manager Inchfredged throws up his door when she passes. She feels how his outstanding pig eyes wander over her body. The distaste feeling, the panic desire to wash herself, wash away all evil attacks. I'm thinking of having a new sauna meeting today, he says with a slimy tone. The distaste suddenly is exchanged by a wall to physical violence just when he has reached the end of his sentence. Nevertheless, she retains her subdued stance and says quietly, "Okay. Fine." And continues with fast steps towards her office. After 20 minutes of idleness, she is out again and sets off for the breakfast room. The coffee at 9 is a sacred moment of the day, when everything else has to be left behind. As she thought and hoped, Lisbeth has taken the lead in the gossip of the recent events in front of a devoted audience. Everything interrupts in breathlessness when Kirsten enters the room. "Look at that," says Lisbeth, and chuckles slightly. The words are like knives cutting through the air towards an apparent destination. While Kirsten sits down at a free table. Perfect angle, she thinks, and then puts a vague smile on her face like a mask. Like that, she says to the crowd that she is no threat. Her subdued actions make Lisbeth keep on going without notice that the victim is now in the room. She must nevertheless get to know what she is, or leave the room. Lisbeth is reasoning. Sometimes she wondered where all this bitterness is coming from. Maybe it could be from all these dreams and ideas that never were realized. Those who only died at the same second they took their first breath of life. Perhaps all this fulfilling anger and lack of perspective is based on that she simply has had too much idleness. That this have made her courage to make her beautiful dreams a reality. To get lost in her predestined emptiness. Kirsten stay put during the whole 15 minutes breakfast break with her slim fingers dancing on her Nokia phone. It is a nervous fumbling like if she was doing something difficult with it. But in fact, her fingertips never touch the surface. On the screen she instead views the whole scene in a micro perspective. The last piece of puzzle is being produced straight in front of her eyes. Under her subdued presence she is peacefully calm. The flame flares out into the dark room. The smile that spreads over her lips hides a bittersweet sarcasm. The computer screen sends a new signal, and the video editor coughs a reply. This night is not for sleep. She, that by so many before, has been awarded a medal of dullness. They totally ignored her cruel creativity. The one who breaks old lines of behavior and turns them into a more passable route, the way forward. Then after hours of fine-tuning with text, moving image, resolution issues, and a final euphoria when the final result meets all her wishes. Then she uploads the video on YouTube. The drowsiness of a long night without sleep sneaks upon her. When she views the first episode with the text, a devious talk is created by envy, and the scene inside the staff manager in Fred's office rolls with phrases like "women do not belong here" and "a whore." Then the scene changes and the text say is spread by haters, and Lisbeth, with her bitter face, makes her entrance and spreads the blatant rumor with a wickedness that cannot be avoided by anybody. The camera is panning and the caption is changed to "a is accepted by idiots," and the audience's empty faces appear. New text and is about the innocent, and an image of the neatly dressed, but outcast Kirsten, shows up. Gossip is created by envy, spread by haters, accepted by idiots, and is about innocence. Never forget that. Finally, a double-bottomed, thanks to the staff at the department store for their involvement, rolls on the screen. Beyond the veils of tiredness, Kirsten is very pleased with her work. Then she pastes the link to the video in an email and sends it to everyone in her mailing list and share it at the same time on Facebook and Twitter. Then she staggers out to her unmade empty bed in the rays of the first lights of dawn. When she wakes up, the YouTube video is already a big success. The board of executives at the department store has no answers, and the management of the whole network of department stores stands without choices. They have to act. The vultures now are landing on the ground. Finally, Death,